Who's the most sympathetic of the family?
The cook.
Yes.
I mean, I think most people would agree that the cook, because he shows it in the original film.
Yep.
He even tries to warn the guys, you know, Jerry and Kirk.
Yeah.
You don't want to take those girls around that house, right? He tries to talk them out of it because he just doesn't want the trouble, right? And he feels sorry for the girls in a way. And I don't think he feels sorry for the guys. I think he's like, don't take those girls up around that house. They don't want to be there.
Yeah.
So he's the most sympathetic, but why does he show the most animosity towards the rest of the family?
So yeah, that's another question. Why is the cook? Because he's dealing with a bunch of idiots.
Bunch of bullshit.
If you're 70 years old or whatever the age is, and you've been dealing with these idiots for the last however old they are. So imagine like a dad.
Well, bash that Johnny upside is gone, don't
he? Who's just had enough, or a grandpa who's had enough, or anybody who's just had enough of all the idiots that are around him. So if it's not the hitchhiker causing problems, running around doing God knows what, hitchhiking around, digging up people. Every time he comes home from the gas station, he's got to figure out what the hell happened.
Yep.
He's got Leatherface at home. He's got Grandpa at home. Like, it's a circus. And now he's got Sissy and Johnny. Johnny's out doing God knows what. He can't rely on Nancy to control him.
No.
So that's why he has such animosity, because he's tired of dealing with them. So every one of his voice lines mostly are in that funny, and it's in the movie too. Like,
yeah.
All those VO lines of the cook yelling at Hitchhiker and Leatherface.
Yep.
That theme we carried over because we didn't want to change his character. And I was never going to step on Kim's characters like that. And all of a sudden the cook likes the hitchhiker.
Sure.
So I kept that consistent with the film. And it makes him funny.
Yeah.
But in the reality is he would be upset because they're idiots.
Well, and truth be told, you just said it. He is. I mean, I don't know what that says about me, but the cook was my favorite character.
Yeah, because he's funny.
He's funny as hell.
Yeah, his one-liners are funny. Yeah. And even in the second movie, he's got tons of dealing with Chop Top. And
absolutely.
He's like, he can never catch a break. And really, that's why the cook is so fed up. Yep. He's just trying to run the gas station. Yeah, they're eating people.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, it's a business. And he's trying to run a business.
And business is good.
And he's got idiots. He's surrounded by idiots. So, you know, in a nice way, right?
Yeah, of course.
Every day is something new. So he's had enough.
Yeah.
So that's why he's so mad.
Well,
I wouldn't want it any other way.
We're going to break down. Let's break down the three original family members that we have created here. We got about probably 20 minutes or so left. We're going to, I don't want to rush through this, but at the same time, we are kind of on a clock here. Let's start off with Sissy. I know she's one you had a blast. With her conception, and you know, there's a lot of mystery and unknown things about her, you know, and that's kind of how it's supposed to be, is the way I've always understood it. But man, just speak at length on Sissy and give us anything cool you could.
So Sissy came from Kim's character Bible. He had a name and he had a paragraph. So if you don't know about Kim's character Bible, it's a book, we call it the character Bible.
Yeah.
Of all the characters he's created for the franchise, especially the first film, and all the characters that you never saw in the first film.
So this character Bible goes back legit 50 years.
Oh, yeah. And there's a lot of characters he wrote for the first film that aren't in the film.
Right.
And no one knows about them.
Yep.
Unless you've seen this character book.
Mm-hmm.
In there was the name Sissy Sunshine Slaughter. And a paragraph about a family member who rebelled against the family, got caught up in the LSD craze 60s, rebelled against the family, and hitchhiked and went around like all the other kids in the Woodstock movement, you know, in that whole freedom, go find yourself movement that the teenagers or 20-year-olds at that time went through.
Sure.
So she got caught up in that, and honestly, she's tired of being, what are you doing today, blah, blah, the cook yelling at her. So she's a free spirit anyway, so she's looking for a way out. So that was all we had for Sissy, was that one paragraph, and it was at that point where we obviously, you know, I got to come up with the design, what she looks like, what she's wearing, her personality.
Sure.
So, yeah, I took Kim's name and a paragraph and created Sissy from that. And I love the idea that she was a drifter and that she was doing stuff the hitchhiker was doing, but far away.
Right.
And not as crazy, at least on the surface.
That's it.
So we needed a really, really beautiful face, which is where Kelly Mittendorf came in. I wanted her to be beautiful so that she could hitchhike and people would pick her up. You know, so she uses truck drivers to get around. She knows how to use people when she needs to.
Yeah.
And she's walking along, hitchhiking. A trucker's going to pick her up, right? So slowly over time, that doesn't always work out for him because she appears normal. And then 3 minutes after talking to her, you make the wrong move. You try to put your hand on her leg. All of a sudden you find yourself with your throat slit. Right? So there were bodies that were being found along the way of I-40.
Carnage.
Yeah, there's a radio broadcast about the terror of I-40, and they're talking about Sissy.
Yep.
And it's hitchhiking from corridor between Cali, Texas and California.
Exactly.
Where she had traveled. And there's even people that survived. There's a radio broadcast about a survivor who had an encounter with her.
Yep.
And they have descriptions of her. And like people at truck stops would be, watch out for this girl. She became a thing, but they really couldn't catch her. So
a lot harder back then to do so.
Like a lot of people,
yeah.
Spahn Ranch was a well-known thing.
Yeah.
It wasn't a secret. There were a lot of people that came and went from that place. There were kids there.
Yeah.
Like, it's not just the people that committed the murders.
It was a large community.
Yes, there was a large community. And Sissy was just one of those, a few people that were there, one of the many, I guess. And, you know, she left before the murders happened. So she was there in the community while they were creating songs and doing all that. And, you know, there when he had his visions of grandeur about all these things. But like Sissy, she can't conform. So even in that scenario, Sissy cannot be controlled. So there was a lot of friction and fighting, and she had to leave. So that's why she didn't hang out there for all those years. And thank God she left before the murders, or she wouldn't be back home. She may have been caught.
Sure.
So, and then she bounced around a couple more places after that. But that was the backstory we have for Sissy. And that's where her singing the Manson songs came from. We knew she was there during the time period when they were coming up with the songs and singing around the fire, doing crazy kumbaya, right?
Yeah.
So we knew that she knew the songs. So that was kind of how that personality kicked in and where we got that from. Then she eventually had to come back home.
Yeah.
Because she ran out of places to go. And now she's back home with the family. So.
And she's back home. And last thing on her, I'm assuming this probably happened when she got back home. But do you want to give us a little bit of the backstory of how she even obtained this bride Sissy dress?
Oh, yeah. So just like her normal dress that she's wearing right now, she took that from a person that she killed.
Told you.
So Sissy was not getting married.
Sissy-based.
There's a poor dead woman somewhere who was getting married and ran into Sissy in their house. Sissy kills her and just goes through her stuff and says, look at this pretty dress. And then puts it on and imagines that's her getting married.
Hmm.
So bride Sissy is not...
It's not like it's her wedding day or...
No, it's a dress she took from a person she murdered.
Got it.
So there's one less bride and wife in the world because of Sissy. So that's where that idea came from with her dress. And Rob, we have some old photos of Sissy. So along the way, like I said, I create lots of stuff that I don't use. Or Sissy evolved over time from looking certain ways into the way that she looks now.
Sure.
And that occurred over the course of a couple of years. You want to pull up like Sissy, Rob?
Here we go.
Oh, wow.
Well, this is a new one.
Shoot.
Yeah, so you can clearly see the wedding dress there. So these were some dress variations. You're probably looking at her leg.
What the hell?
Is that like a mechanical
leg?
Oh my God.
That's a prosthetic leg.
That is cool.
And at one point in her early conception, this has Kelly's face on it, which came later because we wanted to see what it looked like. But we felt that was too close to Vilmer.
Yeah.
So if you're wondering why Sissy has a mechanical leg or a prosthetic leg, it's because at one point we thought that might be cool, but then that would take away from her maybe. I mean, it's tough traveling. And stuff like that. So we didn't want her to be her identity.
Sure.
Like, I think it's more descriptive.
Yeah.
Right. So we kind of, and honestly, Kim was like, that's too much, too close to Vilmer. So we took that off, but it shows you some variations. And I wanted to show you because there's the bride Sissy dress. At one point, we were going to make, I had an idea to maybe make that dress her default outfit. I scrapped the idea because I really love the flower cross on the left, because it looks like an upside down cross, kind of.
It does.
The way the flowers move. And I love the way that dress looked on her, as opposed to something like a wedding dress. But I put that dress up because I wanted you to see the contrast. And this image goes back years. But ultimately, I scrapped it, and I just didn't do it. But when we were talking about new costumes for her and new designs, mm-hmm. we went back to this list and said, okay, now we can do the wedding dress. Now's the time.
Mm-hmm.
So then it's like, oh, where'd she get it? So then we tell people where she got it and the backstory, and they say, let's do it then. So really, the wedding dress is something I had in mind for her a long time ago. I just scrapped it because I wanted that black dress on her, because I just love the way it looks. And at one point, yes, she had a prosthetic leg. And you'll notice she has shoes on.
Yeah.
And boots. Yeah. So we were exploring a lot of different ideas for her. But ultimately, Rob, next one, if you can. Yeah, ultimately, see, there you go. I narrowed it down to combat boots, kind of like this little sneaker in one boot.
I like the boots on her.
Barefoot. Yeah. So ultimately, I thought the boots were trying too hard. And then I thought the one shoe and the one boot was just too obvious. Like, she couldn't even in her mind know that she put two different shoes on.
Right.
So I went against that because, I don't know, visually it was, you see that girl hitchhiking, you're like, I'm not picking her up.
Boots as an option.
Why she got a boot on and a shoe.
Yeah.
It's just another tell that something's not right.
Sure.
So barefoot, she just lost her shoes.
Yeah.
Poor girl.
Yeah.
Look at that poor
girl. She needs help.
She needs help. And that's where I settled on barefoot. It wasn't because I like bare feet. It wasn't because I like dirty bare feet.
Sure.
It was because I don't have a Tarantino foot fetish.
Right.
It wasn't that. It was just because I felt like, that poor girl. She needs my help. Oh, she's walking barefoot? Pick her up. So there's some evolution of Sissy. Rob, there's another one. And this was we were trying to figure out how short we wanted the dress.
The hair, though.
How low the cleavage was going to be.
Like the hair in the face?
The dress shrinks as it gets to the right. But as you can see, it's very subtle. So we had different necklines that I was experimenting with, different lengths, different amount of tears. But I decided on the original one. Was always the best for me.
That last one, I love that last one.
It fit in nicely. It wasn't trying too hard.
Yeah.
We didn't need to oversell like her. She's already just beautiful. We didn't need to go, hey, now the cleavage is low, and now you can see half her butt hanging out because there's a rip. We didn't need to go down that route because she already was perfect. But at one point, we did think about that.
Yeah, I like the tears.
She does have this, and Kelly gets a lot of credit for that. Just a unique beauty, you know?
Yes, and sometimes you can go overboard with that and try too hard.
Yeah.
So this was me going, wait a minute, what's it actually look like? Let's make it so I can see it visually to know that I don't want it. Yeah, so there's another one too, I think. There's some really old designs of Sissy. This is going to blow your mind. Ready? Yep.
Oh, my gosh. We need it. We need it.
I have never seen this before.
Here is
a blonde, non-Kelly Mittendorf version with these baby doll kind of dresses on that. But once again, they have shoes and socks on, and that dress, those type of dress were very, very popular.
They were.
And I didn't want to just do something that you had seen before. So while this looks awesome, I ultimately still decided that black dress was so unique.
No, we need this. What?
Whereas these...
Put this in the game. Oh, my God.
You know, the pigtails were very, very obvious. Right.
Yo.
And I didn't want her to be too much Harley Quinn.
Good point.
I get the Harley Quinn.
I stayed away from this, even though I love this character.
We need it.
I still wanted to stick to the black dress. So, next one. Once again, dark hair now.
Oh, my God.
She's got these ripped.
What the freak?
She has shoes on.
We need these cosmetics.
I mean, they're cool for the time period.
Her hair is cool, but I like the hair that she has now. But we need these cosmetics.
When I compared them to her black dress with the flowers, and I wanted to tie in the flowers.
Yeah.
There's a constant theme of wildflowers in our game.
There is.
Sissy uses the flowers. The flowers are what links Maria to Johnny. The flowers are on the map. It takes place during wildflower season. So that's really part of the reason why I stuck with the dress.
The flowers are almost a character within the game.
They are. And if it's Sissy. So even though I like this stuff, and I always did, I felt the other one was better, and I wanted really just that to happen. So, is that all of Sissy?
Yeah, I think that's
four. No, it's one more.
We got one more?
Yeah, and at one point I had short hair.
Oh, wow. Shoot.
And there's the prosthetic leg, which was still an awesome idea. I love it, but Vilmer. We didn't want to step on Vilmer's toes.
Yeah.
So we had to cut that. And there's one boot, one shoe.
It was probably for the best.
But yeah, like the short hair version was
always kind of cool. Oh, what the freak?
I picture her cutting her hair with that razor.
Yeah.
To get away from the
We need this.
So along the way, that was me envisioning that her changing her look on the fly.
While she was...
No, like everybody who's looked in a mirror ever and shaved their head thinking that that's going to stop the authorities from finding them in a movie.
Yep.
When they just cut their hair in the mirror. That scene.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. So there's a little... I wanted to share a little bit of pre-Kellen Mittendorf, pre-Sissy as you know her. The evolution of her from the first time we thought about her until now, and all the thought process that goes into the character. So all the other characters pretty much have these as well, but we're not going to share them all today. I just wanted to look at Sissy because she was a tough look to nail down. But once I found Kelly's face and, Wes did his magic to do all the legal work to get her face in a game with her.
Yep.
And she was on board. That really, her face in that dress and the no shoes just works for me.
Yep.
It was perfect for me. So, yeah.
We're going to be working overtime today.
That's fine.
We very rarely get you in here. So we'll roll through the rest of this, but we're on. Let's move on. I think
Johnny.
Yeah. Let's move on to Johnny.
Johnny boy, Jonathan, Papa John.
It's no secret that the community has really glommed onto this character.
You think?
Yeah.
You think?
He is a TikTok sensation.
Time to play.
There is a portion of TikTokers out there and people who are obsessed with Johnny and haven't even played our game yet.
They like the way he looks and they want to make thirsty reels out of him, which is fine. So, which was funny because we have this obsession with serial killers, right? We have an obsession with good-looking serial killers. And that's a thing that I'm not going to get into because that's a whole psychological thing.
Yeah.
Right? It would take me all day.
It literally would.
Yeah, yeah. That's a thing that exists on both sides. Yeah. So it's for female serial killers and for male. We're attracted to things like that. So along the way, when I was thinking of characters for Johnny, I was like, who's he resemble and what's he look like? And I knew I wanted him to be Ted Bundy, to be able to go out into the world and exist without you knowing he's trying to kill you. So I needed him to be able to have that facade. So, and then there's part Night Stalker, who wasn't as attractive as Ted Bundy. Yep. Like teeth were
Richard Ramirez, right?
His teeth were like half. Yeah. When he smiled, you knew you were in trouble.
Yeah.
He wasn't well maintained.
Yeah.
Right. But I tried to create a mixture of the two. Someone that was lethal, but could go out and exist in small towns and spring up here and there and not set off a red flag.
Right.
You wouldn't know he was following you until it was too late.
Yeah.
And even if he was following you, you wouldn't be maybe that scared because you're like, oh, it's that guy again. So Johnny came from a lot of research on serial killers. One little story I've told like two people ever. At one point, Johnny didn't talk a lot. He wasn't laughing. He wasn't outgoing.
Okay.
He wasn't completely the narcissistic guy that you see today that's talking to you while you're dying and laughing at you and, walking around looking for, and you're like, I know you're here. He's a very confident guy.
Yeah.
Talks a lot. And that wasn't always Johnny's personality. A long time ago, I had Johnny very cold and calculated, and he wasn't saying a lot. And I wanted him to be more evil and less relatable. Right now he's kind of like a mixture of Billy Loomis from Scream, where he's just shit-talking to Neve Campbell, right? You're playing with her, and that's what he does a lot. And a lot of that came from Billy Loomis. But that's a very outgoing character.
Yeah,
he wasn't always like that. And here's the story. So the Texas Killing Fields, there's an area, in League City. If you've seen the documentary, The Texas Killing Fields.
Oh, on Netflix, yeah.
Before that came out, on one of my Texas trips, I don't know why, I researched way too much and went to real locations where things had happened, like cult-wise, serial killer locations, places like that. Just try to figure out let's do research. And it was too much, right? But I did it anyway. And I was like, you know what? I want to. There was a phone booth that they mentioned in that documentary that I wanted to find because I was near that area. I go, I'll find this. So I think I know where, I know the main, it's on Main Street, and I think I know where it is. And I get there, and I'm sitting in the parking lot, and I have this little book I don't have on me where I write all my ideas down in. I was trying to figure out what Johnny was. And the phone booth is different. It wasn't actually there. It was moved a little bit. And sure. It's a new gas station. And I look over, and it's at the corner of Main Street and Hobbs, which is my last name. Literally, I did not know this.
What?
I looked over and I see Hobbs, and I'm just like,
"That is
this
freaky.
Is fuck. This is messed up, and this
is
too weird,
wild, dude."
And it was at that point where I was like, "This is enough. I'm done." I don't know what it was about seeing that side street named Hobbs, Main and Hobbs. I'm like, "What are the chances that my last name is 10 feet from me?" And I'm sitting there trying to look at this damn payphone for what? This is stupid. This is too much, right? And so it's that point where I go, you know what? I don't want to make him that cold and calculated. It was too eerie.
Yeah.
And when I looked at the area where, like, the field, the main field where sure. they found a lot of those victims, I was like, I don't want to play into that anymore. I want to turn Johnny into this boisterous, outgoing character who can hide some of the fact that he's a disgusting dude. Behind some of the lines and so that's laughing and smiling. Because yeah. at one point he wasn't.
Right.
And it became too cold and too calculated. Yep. And when I saw that sign.
That's when that I was pushed like, you in another direction.
Yes, I was like, that's overboard. So it's a funny story that I never really told anyone. A lot of people here don't even know the story. But yeah, just weird seeing that. And that at that point, Johnny took a turn to be more outgoing. He's still saying some nasty stuff.
Yeah.
But he's, I don't know, there's something about him that works because people enjoy the way he talks and messes with you and plays with his food and the hunt. Yep. It's almost so overboard that it takes away from the coldness in a way.
Yep.
So that's how he happened. That's how that happened because I looked over and saw a damn sign with my name on it while I was looking at a payphone where the serial killer would watch people at a payphone and that's how he would track them.
That is absolutely.
It was just so weird. I was like, okay. Dial it back. So we have some old photos of Johnny that people are going to laugh at. Rob, you want to pull them up?
All right,
get
ready.
So Johnny went through several variations too. Here you go.
Oh, and my God. Look, so the white like shirt is fire.
One of my favorite movies is The Outsiders.
Oh, yeah.
It's one of my favorite movies. And Matt Dillon.
That's, wow. Yeah,
this
I see it.
I always love that character. But what's funny
oh,
is
oh,
he's
Johnny,
got Maria
the
tattoo. And for the
nice touch, Ronnie.
For the longest time, I had a side story in my head where he really, really, really liked Maria. Right?
Like genuinely liked
her. Yeah, so I wanted to see what it would look like if he did a homemade tattoo. Now, that wasn't the tattoo I was going to use.
Right.
But if you're wondering why there's a Maria tattoo, it's because I wanted to see it, and I wanted to maybe explore that, but it was unreasonable. Like, it wasn't going to ever really occur. It wasn't going to happen. It was kind of just a pipe dream, and I wanted to experiment with that. Yeah. Like, what if he did want to leave the family?
Yep.
What if he? This was her that he found that got him out of that life. But that's not how serial killers work. They don't all of a sudden just go, "Oh, I like that girl. I'm going to quit being a serial killer." It may last a year. It may last 2 years.
Yeah.
And then they go back to killing. Help. So it was a pipe dream. It's a fairy tale.
Serial killers have had
sure
wives
some
for decades and were serial killing during their marriage.
Exactly. Yeah. So I always thought this, and plus this is really too good looking. Like, this guy is really, really kind of suave. And
He's definitely leaner and more, you know, like, especially in the abdomen.
So he just
area.
Didn't work for me.
Yeah.
Like, but I love it, but it didn't work for me personally.
I agree.
So there's another one, I think. So here's some old sketches of faces.
Oh, shoot.
The one we're going to use at the top left, we did use. But this is where I was like, okay, I need him to be more friendly.
Oh, my God.
But I didn't really know. I started down a path of like, to me, the guy on the right looks like someone you would see at a gas station, like in a small town.
Right?
Right. So it was that innocent-looking face that you wouldn't know, that you wouldn't particularly know he was going to kill you. He could fit in anywhere.
That bottom right looked creepy.
Whereas
17?
I needed him to be darker, though. I needed him to be more brooding.
Yeah.
Which is where Johnny on the top left comes in. So we went through a lot of variations of face, a lot more than this. But this was almost his face. That bottom left one was almost his face in a way, but it just wasn't cold enough. You know, I needed him to be a little bigger, a little stronger, a little more menacing looking, a little more cold. Like, look at his eyes up there and look at the guy on the bottom.
Oh, yeah.
The guy on the bottom looks like he may be up to something, but Johnny up there.
He's more inviting.
Yes, he's more friendly.
Yes.
So I needed more cold brooding. So eventually we did land on that top left photo. That hair's not the same. I forget where that hair. We went through like 400 versions of hair. But yeah, it's funny that Johnny almost looked like one of those other people there. Because we found a lot of like old photos of like small town Texas gas stations. And there was always just like a regular looking dude in there helping. Yeah. Right? Some 20-year-old dude in there helping.
Yeah.
Who didn't look evil. He didn't look nice. Nope. Just in between. Just hanging out in between. And so, yeah, ultimately, though, Johnny, to me, his face is where I wanted it to be. And it took us a long time to get there because I didn't really know what I wanted.
Sure.
But, yeah, we messed with a lot of different variations. So, yep. What else? Is there another?
One more?
I forgot. I don't even know what this is. What is this? Oh, here you go. So,
Shoot. He needs the white shirt.
The whole time. So I was going to launch the game with shirtless Johnny. He never had a shirt on. However, I could never personally get the muscles where I wanted them.
Mm.
I just couldn't figure out what I liked. So it wasn't even an art thing. It was me personally. I could never get him to look the way I wanted because I didn't know what I wanted his muscles to look like. So
that's
about
a little frustrating. The creative process.
It's frustrating because I'm like, he's not perfect. I can't get him perfect.
Yeah. Then you start to probably get in your head a little bit. And
let's play it safe and put a shirt on him. And at this point, I didn't know what shirt I wanted. I didn't know if I wanted the standard white tee that you see at every gas station or a shirt that's cut off.
Right.
So ultimately, I went with the shirt that's cut off, but there's his old body. It's kind of beefy a little bit. It's not the same body we have now, but I figured people might enjoy.
Definitely still in shape, but just a more step in the dad bod direction.
Yes. You know? And less ripped, but still there's still some muscle mass.
Yeah. I mean that.
But it's funny to see this photo now because
I would kill for that body. You kidding me?
Yeah. That white t-shirt was always something that it was very obvious. It was very James Dean.
Yeah.
It was very 1950s.
Gotcha.
It was very obvious I feel like Johnny would have found a t-shirt and just ripped the sleeves off. So that's why we settled on that look. And then eventually I go, you know what? I think someone mentioned shirtless Johnny somewhere and I go, you know what? Let's do it. So after the game came out and we found our footing again and, you know, started releasing DLC. I was like, okay, we're going to go do shirtless Johnny. So, but at one point he was going to be shirtless. It's just, I had to change course and put a shirt on him just because of my own personal skill level could not get him where I wanted him to be. So is that it for Johnny?
Yep.
Okay, cool.
All right. Just got a few questions about Johnny before we move on to Nancy.
Yep.
We know he was taken by...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right? So
yes.
About what age...
Oh, yeah, there's good stuff for Johnny.
So let's go back to the...
He's a toddler.
Yeah, so he's a toddler.
He's a toddler.
And what happened when he was...
He doesn't remember it, obviously.
Obviously.
So Judith, his mom.
Okay.
They were traveling through.
Judith?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that was when the business was happening. Salvage business with Nancy and her husband, one of her husbands.
So what happened to him?
She's like, this is a place of business. I'm lost.
Right.
I'll knock on this looks safe because there's flowers and it's well kept and it looks like a business because it was a salvage yard before husbands died and Nancy closed it down.
Sure.
And it is what you see today. So rewind 20 something years when Johnny's a toddler, it was a different place. So she feels safe enough to stop and ask for directions because you either have a map or you don't.
Yeah.
Her and Johnny and her mother were actually leaving. She was leaving his dad.
Oh.
So he was abusive.
Okay.
So she was leaving him and took Johnny with her to find a better life. I know. Unfortunately, she stops at Nancy's house.
Is there a happy ending?
No, no one has a happy ending, my man. This is not Disney Channel.
This is the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
So she says, okay, I'm traveling through here. I'm looking for this other town. I think I'm going the right way. Let's stop and ask. Right, so they stop. And one thing about Nancy is you ask, if you want to talk, I have to fast forward real quick and go back.
Yeah.
Nancy's husbands could never give her what she wanted, which is a baby. They all failed. one by one, and she killed them for it.
That's pretty cold.
Yeah, I mean, she wanted a kid.
Wow.
Turns out
that's some deep shit.
Turns out she's the problem, not them. But she doesn't know that because
sure
you don't get tested.
Wow.
You know, it's 19, whatever it is. So she's blaming them.
Yeah.
And one by one, none of these husbands can give her a baby. She wants her own little kid. And it's hard to go out and kidnap a kid, I guess. So she doesn't go out and just take a kid, right? You get caught. So she blames husbands, knocks off the husbands one at a time. Finally, here at her front door is a baby.
A beautiful
dark-haired little baby. Unfortunately, it's got a mother with it. So she's like, yeah, come on in. And Nancy ends up killing her mom, Johnny's mom.
Yep.
However,
Judith,
not
right?
Yeah, but yeah. Not before Johnny's mom hits her in the eye with something and blinds Nancy in that eye.
Let's go.
So that's how she got.
So that eye is
from Johnny's mom.
Wow. W Johnny's mom.
There's been some good fan art of that eye.
You know, it's not fully blinded, but you can see.
Yeah.
Like, you know, so yeah, Johnny's mother gave that to her.
She tried. Wow.
So then Nancy has a baby. So there's another question, I think, and maybe you're going to ask it.
Yeah.
How does he ever find out?
Yeah.
Does he know?
Is he aware of what happened to his mother? Who his mother even is?
Yeah. For the longest time, he didn't know because he was a kid.
Yeah.
He has, you know Dexter, right?
Obviously. Yeah, of course.
Born in blood.
Yep.
That whole flashback where he doesn't know what happened, but he feels like something happened. He
right.
has those memories.
Yeah.
And then, of course, he hangs out with the hitchhiker. Okay, all the time. So you think the hitchhiker
it always comes back to the hitchhiker?
You think the cook and the hitchhiker is going to keep that secret?
No.
Especially the hitchhiker
can't keep it.
So the hitchhiker teases him. That's not even your real mama, mama. You know, you're not part of the family.
Oh,
your mom's dead. You know. So the hitchhiker.
So hitchhiker.
He lets it out of the bag. So when Johnny gets old enough. He's doing right. He's 10, then 11, then 12, then 13, and 14, and 15, and he's growing up and being a big, strong guy.
Yeah.
That she slowly taught how to kill and to manipulate and turn him into the monster he is.
Yeah.
He confronts her, gets mad, and was going to try to kill her.
Oh, shoot.
He's had enough, right? He, like any teenager, he lashes out, and then she cuts him across his face.
Oh.
Is that how he got
That's how he got his face scar. He stepped up to Nancy, and she put him in his place. When he was a young teenager. So, you know, he...
He had a strict mother, guys.
He did. So, but yeah, he finds that Hitchhiker sees him about his mom.
Be hot.
That he told her the truth.
That little shit.
Yep.
He's such an asshole.
He confronts her. And then there's a confrontation. Johnny's kind of throwing her around a little bit. And Nancy, because she's cold, and she puts him in his place and beats him and cuts him across his face and says, if you don't want any more of that, I'd quit. You know, and Nancy, wow. I mean, Johnny's not fully... huge yet. He's still a kid.
Yeah.
Right? At that point. And it's the only mother he has.
So that's all he knows.
So Johnny is torn.
Dang.
That's a question that's coming up. It's how does he feel about Nancy and their relationship?
Yes.
He knows.
What's that dynamic
at this point, it's Stockholm Syndrome. At this point, he's in the family. He's eating people.
Yeah.
What are you going to do?
So he is partaking in the cannibalism.
Yeah, and that was a question someone had.
Yeah, that was from your IG. They want to know if he eats.
Yeah, and... Yes, he does, but it's not a thing he seeks out to do. It's because it's just ingrained in the family.
Yeah.
Mm. He enjoys the hunt. He enjoys going out to get away.
Sure.
Get away from Nancy. There's also that dynamic. The more time I spend away from this lady, even though she's my mom, even though she did what she did, I'm kind of stuck here.
Yeah.
Or he can do the sissy route and leave. But in a weird way, he doesn't. You know, he still comes and goes.
That's all he knows.
Yeah, that's all he knows. It's like
that's sad,
figuring
Johnny.
Out your parents are a serial killer. I don't know. It's a weird thing.
Yeah, I can imagine.
That's where Johnny's face scar came from. Oh, and someone had a question about the other scars on his body. Those are all from fights. Either the victim's fighting back.
Mm-hmm.
TMI.
Mm-hmm.
If you study choking victims.
Yeah.
Usually when someone chokes someone, they extend their arms so they can't. Claw your face.
Yeah.
So any of the scars you see on his upper body, your chest.
From strangulation.
Yes. Yeah. You never just do this. You keep them.
It's true.
You tilt your head back. So That was also a moment where I was like, I'm not looking at this anymore. Just to get a scar right.
Right.
But some of the bigger scars are from fights. He fights dudes. He doesn't care.
Yeah.
Johnny's out getting in fist fights, getting stabbed in the back by people, getting, you know, roughing up in a bar, getting bottles broken over his head and back. So, yeah, a lot of those are self-defense from his victims, but a lot of them are just him fighting. You know, getting in situations he has to fight himself out of. You know, so. But, yeah, the one on his face is from Nancy.
That's,
yeah, wow. She's evil. That's what I said. Even her bio says, even monsters have makers. Right?
So on brand.
So, yeah. You know, and is whatever you feel about Johnny.
Yep.
She did it. Nancy's the real problem. Like, she made Johnny.
She did. So
he's just some innocent kid who got
that's it.
Which I like the sympathy.
Yeah.
Like, there's always, what happened? Oh, that poor serial killer. I'm going to write him a letter in prison because what he went through as a kid.
Yeah.
Determined what he is now. Poor baby.
How they're so intertwined. We've actually covered a decent amount of Nancy while talking about Johnny.
Yeah.
You know, the whole dynamic of them is, I know the community, I know I see it all the time. There's always questions about their connection. And
yeah, the family connection?
Yeah, and all that. Like,
well, here's the deal about
Nancy I'll just come out and say it. There was a trailer and there was a shot.
Oh, God.
Nancy and Cook.
Caught it.
Nancy and Cook.
And, you know, I laughed in the community because y'all can be funny sometimes. I got to be honest. But at the end of the trailer, there's a shot of the cook and Nancy sitting next to each other, standing next to each other.
I mean,
are they by any chance, what is the connection there? Are they an item?
No.
Okay.
The hitchhiker and Nancy are not.
What? They not banging? He not okay, hitting that? Look,
how many family photos do you have of people in your family standing next to each other?
Look
on that wall.
Yes.
Like,
I can just tell you.
He's got his hand on her shoulder because they're part of the family.
My job, you know, our job every day in communities, you know, is to interact on the
social.
Talk to folks. And the reaction I saw, one of the first comments I saw was literally, wait, is Cook and Nancy? And I'm like, no.
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 Okay. And they do eat people. Okay. So it's not a stretch to be like, oh, God, how dare they have relations.
Yep.
But no, they're not.
So what is the association?
Here's the thing about Kim Hinkle. So the reason, look back at the original film. People go, I'll get to Nancy in a second. People say, who is the cook? What's his relationship? What about Leatherface and the hitchhiker? Kim didn't want you to know. Now, all we do know is that Hitchhiker and Leatherface are brothers.
Brothers.
Because we hear the cook say, look what your brother did to the door. Not look what my brother did.
Your brother.
Not look what our brother did.
Sure.
And they don't even say, where's your grandpa? Or take him to our grandpa. All we know is he's grandpa.
Yep.
We don't know if he's their grandpa.
We don't.
Or some dude's grandpa. It's not the point. He's just grandpa. We just know Hitchhiker and Leatherface are brothers. So we don't know what the cook is.
Yeah.
People assume that he's like the third brother or the dad.
Yeah.
But it's never said.
He's not.
The cook doesn't say, hey, son.
And honestly, it works in the film.
Yes.
And I think it works in
the film. And he doesn't want people to know. So talking to Kim, what I didn't want to do, he's like, Sissy just is. You don't know where she came from, and I want to keep it that way. She could be the cook's daughter.
Yep.
She could be a niece. She could be anything. And Nancy continues that trend of she's just part of the family. Okay. Some people might be like, oh, she's the cook's sister. Or is she Sissy's mom? Right? Clearly not, because the way they talk to each other.
Yeah.
But he wanted it to be just ambiguous.
Bro, Nancy and Sissy be going at it.
Less you know sometimes, the better. We know.
Yeah.
You see these horror movies that explore.
Absolutely.
The kid's origin, and you're like, it's too much.
The
mystery.
The less is more approach in the first film that Kim was going for, I think.
We kept that throughout the characters for the most part.
And that is carryover to
the games. I would never step on his characters and all of a sudden tell you that the cook is the dad. I would never say that because that's not what he wanted.
Yep.
And it's not up for me to say.
You're not going
to
say cook's the brother either.
No. And any new characters that I come up with, if I feel like they need a mom or a dad or a brother or a sister, I'll say it specifically.
Sure.
But yeah, I'm in the mindset that we don't need to know because I wanted to be faithful to Kim and his characters and that world and that lore. So yeah, but no, they are not having sex, sir.
That's good to know.
Okay.
Okay, we've settled that finally, community.
Yes.
Cook and Nancy.
Nancy has several husbands that are dead.
And we've seen what. Yeah.
So she didn't need the cook.
You think she loved any of those husbands? Or was she just.
No, she, I mean.
The first one.
She did.
Yeah.
But at the same time, she's a psycho.
Yeah.
So define love for a psycho. Yeah. She loves him because she needs him.
She needed a child.
Yeah. And when they couldn't do that, she got rid of him. Dang. So, yeah. Is that it for Nancy? What are the questions on
there's
there?
There's a couple more here.
All right.
Because we are about to close up shop here, guys. But
we'll go over the final list of questions.
For sure. Just there's a few left. We actually hit up a good amount of them.
Just to make sure.
Let's see. I guess talk a little bit. Because we definitely got to get out of here. We're running up on 2 hours now. We're about 20 minutes over schedule. Because we started right at...
It's okay.
Yeah, we're good. Okay. The dynamic relationship between... What is really that... especially everything you've touched on with Johnny. Things he found out. The hitchhiker blabbing his mouth. You know, what is that relationship like? The dynamic between Johnny and Nancy?
I think it's
from each side, I guess.
You ever heard a teenager, even though Johnny's not a teenager, where a mom or a dad's like, sweetie, let's go. And then teenager's like, hey, fuck you, mom. We like this. So, you know, and then the mom's like, oh, sweetie, don't say that. They're oblivious to getting stepped on by their kids.
Uh-huh.
So there's a lot of that, of Johnny telling her, be quiet, I hate you. Or, you know, it's a rocky, volatile relationship.
It's understandable considering that Nancy killed his biological mother.
It's not just, oh, I love you.
Yeah.
Now, she is. Johnny, don't say that.
Right.
Johnny.
That's why I said both, because it's
baby, don't say that.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, it's rocky because Johnny knows what happened. And he'll never forgive her for it. But at the same time, he still exists in that world. So what's he going to do? It's either leave or deal with it, or kill her.
That's tough. Kill her.
So maybe one day he does kill her. Who knows?
Stay tuned for that.
Who knows? I mean, he's a cold-blooded killer at the end of the day. Yeah. So just like Sissy, you push him too
far. I think eventually he does.
I will. Speaking of love, I will want to clear one thing up.
Sure.
The word sweetie.
Yeah.
Someone asked me, in our game, does not mean love, by the way.
It does not mean love.
No, it's like your grandmother. They think because certain characters say, oh, sweetie.
Oh, sweetie. Yeah. That's
it's a southern term of endearment. It's the way that your grandmother would say, oh, sweetie, it's okay.
Yeah.
To a kid. Or a parent may say, sweetie, calm down. So
Danny's saying sweetie to Julie does not mean he likes her.
It was used in the 50s, 60s, 70s, correct. And 80s. So if you're not from the South and didn't grow up in that time, I can see why you think it would mean love. But yeah, a lot of our characters call each other sweetie, calm down. Oh, sweetie, right? It doesn't mean that they're lovers. It just means they care about each other in a protective kind of way. It's something you would say to coddle someone and try to be like, I got you. Sweetie, it's okay. Not, hey, baby.
No, it's definitely not that.
So I just want to clear that up because I know people have been thinking about it for a year or two now.
Yeah.
Because they hear it, they see the VO lines, but yeah.
No, that checks out. But yeah, at that... In the South, especially in that time, like you said,
yes.
Going back
I mean, my
50s.
Grandmother called everyone sweetie.
Same.
I mean, sweetie, hey, sweetie. Like, it's just a thing was there. Yeah.
I'm going to get to a couple questions that you had from your Instagram, and then we're going to close up the shop because I'm sure everyone out there is not too happy with us.
So yeah.
Let's move on.
It's 5 o'clock.
Let's move on. This is actually a good question. How did you come up with the family members' abilities?
Oh, I mean, yeah, I'd start with their looks. And figure out, well, I know Johnny's easy because I want him to be a stalker and a predator.
Hunter.
So him tracking people
yep.
makes complete sense, right? Because that's how Absolutely. He would find you. The cook's old, so hearing aid. Plus, he would know the entire map completely because he's one of the oldest members.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like he would pick up on creaks and cracks.
Sure.
So that's how we did the noise. Sissy, flowers. What can she do with the flowers? What does she do with flowers? That was always a thing. Oh, grind them up into a poison.
Yeah.
So... And then it's the hitchhiker. Of course he would be making gnarly traps out of bones and stuff, because that's what that freak does.
I like Johnny's line. How do you make those weird traps?
Yeah, how do you make those weird-ass traps? Yeah, exactly. So it's a visual thing. Yes. It's a visual thing that plays into the way they look.
Yeah.
What is the thing that that works for gameplay based on? So you have lots of ideas for abilities, and you narrow it down to one that fits the look of the character. Nancy in her eye. And Nancy pulling out barbed wire, because that's something that she would do, because she's insane. It's the opposite of what she looks like.
It's true.
So really, that's how you come up with it.
That's super cool.
It's part visual.
Yeah.
And what works for gameplay.
Yeah, obviously. So, yeah. Because
not to gloss
can't
over it.
Can't ignore that.
Not to gloss over it. But yeah. And also, the victims also have things that tie into the personality. Toughness for Anna. Picking locks for Connie because she can fix things on the fly. And then Julie.
Absolutely.
Stamina. So Sonny highlighting, using his smarts and his wits. Those are all just character traits, the way they were written, trying to show that in the game world visually. So yeah, once you have the character's bio and what they are as a person,
makes that so
you,
much
makes easier. That a little bit easier.
Yeah.
You just have to figure out what works and what's too gamey, not too gamey, where's the line at. So
yeah. One last question we had here is so pre like the first film, right? Pre our game, Sally, for instance, from the first film.
Yeah.
Did anyone ever escape the family?
No. Or else they'd be caught. Now, Johnny has gone out, and we know he's failed.
Yep.
Because the Pflugerville incident, where he got his scar in his shoulder. There was multiple girls in that house. He thought there was one. He wakes up and all of a sudden gets stabbed by a friend. And, you know.
Like, yeah.
So those two people know they survived.
Absolutely.
Right? And Sissy has survivors. Like, they mess up when they're out away from the house. But
that's
no
how
one
mistakes
has.
Mistakes happen.
Yes, exactly. No one has survived the house.
Got it.
Encounters. But that doesn't mean that there aren't people who survived out in the wild who know what Johnny looks like and they know what Sissy looks like. But once again, there's no internet. What would they, when the police ask you what they look like, you tell them, but okay. There's no database.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. You can get away with a lot back then.
Yep.
You know, so, but yeah, no one survived. Sally's the first to leave the family house, which is why it's not there in the sequel.
That makes sense.
Yep. Sally's solely responsible for them going through the tunnels.
Yeah.
In part two.
For running.
Yeah. They had to leave because she knows where the house is.
Yeah.
And they're on the run. So
way down there and whatever they say in the movie.
Yeah.
But, dude, this was a lot of fun. Before I get you out of here, I have one request. Please never give Cook a horse in the game. Can we never do that?
The good news is we're not going to do any horse tech.
That's good.
After the tragedy, it's only been a couple weeks. They haven't had time to get closer. So you would think that after a tragedy like that,
sure.
Your sister's missing, my girlfriend's missing.
Yeah.
We grow close over time.
Sure.
And if it was months and months and months, they certainly would, because people find solace.
We didn't have months and months.
No. So
or they didn't, I should say.
They didn't.
Yeah.
So they only had, you know, about a week before they start going, oh, God, she's missing. What are we going to do? And, yeah, they're talking on the phone and trying to console each other. But they don't have the time to nurture that relationship that usually happens.
Right.
When someone goes missing and the brother and this other person or the sister become close.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they would. Absolutely. He would be trying to take care of her. Danny absolutely would.
Especially someone what he's been through.
If he didn't go to this house and there was a different story and they got close to each other,
yep.
Danny would absolutely try to take care of Anna.
Love it.
And completely be the big brother and make sure that she was good and taken care of. So he'd be at their house talking to the mom and consoling them. And he may have even moved there.
Sounds like a happy ending.
Yeah, well, I said if.
That's a if. Fair.
If.
Fair. I tried to squeeze one out of you before we got out of here.
Nope.
Not happening.
Okay, I think we're done.
Yeah, I think we're going to wrap this up. We went over about a good 20, 30 minutes here.